In this video, I'll explain an ingenious model for multiple sclerosis. This model makes it a lot easier to understand the complex progression of the disease. Did you know that even when we completely stop MS relapses, say with super effective medication, we might still get new MS symptoms over time? I didn't. But after this model, I understand why that can happen. My name is Bram Platel. I'm a doctor, not a medical doctor, but a doctor of science. I have a PhD in biomedical engineering. Also, I'm the founder and director of a Dutch non-profit foundation called Stichting MS in Beeld. Most of the time, we make understandable but in-depth YouTube videos about complex scientific MS-related topics. Up to now, our videos have all been in Dutch. This English video is kind of an experiment. Let me know if I should make more content in English by giving this video a thumbs up or leaving a comment below. By the way, I'm also an MS patient myself, and this model improved my understanding of the subtleties of my own MS, and I wanted to share it with you as I'm sure that it will help you as well. The model is actually called a topographical model of MS in this 2015 paper by Steven Krieger. But I first heard about it in a YouTube video by Aron Boster, who referred to it as the leaking pool model. By the way, if you don't know Dr. Boster, you definitely should look up his YouTube channel. Okay, let's talk about the model. It distinguishes three different regions of the central nervous system. These are 1. The spinal cord and the optic nerves, 2. The brainstem and the cerebellum, and 3. The cerebral hemispheres. These areas, they differ by their amount of functional reserve. The spinal cord and the optic nerves have far less functional reserve as the lobes of the brain, also called the cerebrum or the cerebral hemispheres. This means that the nervous system can't deal with damage to the spinal cord or the optic nerves as well as it can deal with damage somewhere else in the brain. The spinal cord and the optic nerves are relatively thin structures, and they transfer an enormous amount of information. Signals there, they can't be relayed to bypass areas that have been damaged by an inflammation, and therefore lesions in these areas hardly go unnoticed. On the other hand, the cerebral hemispheres are relatively large. They have some redundancy and plasticity. And because of this, lesions in the cerebrum sometimes go completely unnoticed. In the topographical model, the functional reserve is represented by the depth of our pool, like here. The functional capacity of the brain is often measured by the brain volume. In our model, it's represented by the amount of water in our pool. When the brain shrinks, functional capacity is reduced and therefore functional reserve gets less. In MS, they distinguish worsening due to neuroinflammation during a relapse and worsening due to neurodegeneration. Let's look at relapse-associated worsening, aka RAW. In the topographic model, lesions are represented by stalagmites rising from the bottom of the pool. The water surface represents the clinical threshold, so peaks that break through the water surface that cross the threshold, they cause noticeable symptoms. The stalagmite in this example could represent an inflammation of the optic nerve. And when it breaks through the water surface, this lesion could cause blurry vision in the left eye, for example. After a while, the acute inflammation will subside, and the stalagmite, the lesion, might reduce beneath the surface of the water, meaning that the clinical symptom disappears completely. progression independent from relapse activity, a.k.a. PIRA, or neurodegeneration, is depicted as the decline of the water level in our pool. This represents the gradual depletion of functional capacity. In this case, we have three identical lesions in each region. Let's say one in the spinal cord, one in the brainstem, and one in the cerebrum. When the water level recedes due to neurodegeneration, it might uncover all damage. As soon as such a lesion crosses the clinical threshold, the patient notices a deficit. Here you can see that the lesions in the areas to the left are uncovered sooner, even though they are identical. Let's look at the different stages or types of MS as they are currently defined. The first clinical attack is called a CIS, a clinically isolated syndrome. A CIS is a first event in which a single or multiple lesions break the water surface. Such a lesion might remain above the clinical threshold, leaving residual deficits, or it might, as depicted here, recede again beneath the water surface. After this, a patient feels completely recovered. However, even though the symptoms disappeared, damage underneath the surface of the water remains. This is important to realize. Every relapse, neuroinflammation, will leave damage, even if you don't feel it. A CIS might turn into RRMS, relapsing remitting MS. More neuroinflammation might occur, causing more lesions, stalagmites, to rise from the bottom of our pool. Some might break their surface and be noticed, others can remain completely submerged. These hidden lesions might be picked up on an MRI scan, but not always. As the disease progresses, more lesions might appear. Many patients convert from RRMS to SPMS, secondary progressive MS. This progressive phase of the disease is characterized by a constant decrease in functional capacity. New lesions might still occur. The neurologist will then call it active SPMS, but the water level in our pool keeps going down. Lesions at once breach the surface but later drop below the clinical threshold and remain submerged and thus no longer cause any deficits can once again cause symptoms when the water level drops and uncovers them. That's why old symptoms might reappear over time. The receding water level can also uncover old damage that never crossed the water surface before. This means that even in the absence of neuroinflammation, entirely new symptoms can arise. When I first realized this, I was astonished. I always thought that new symptoms that lasted more than 24 hours were caused by a relapse. Primary progressive MS, PPMS, is similar to SPMS, only now the relapsing phase of the disease is absent, and significant neurodegeneration is present from the beginning of the disease. What can also occur is that a lesion is visible on MRI, but never crosses the clinical threshold, so the stalagmite or the lesion remains submerged. This is called an RIS, a RIS, a radiologically isolated syndrome. You don't notice anything, but the MRI scan shows a demyelinated lesion. The disease course of MS is a complex mixture of relapses, also referred to as disease activity or neuroinflammation, and progression, neurodegeneration. The topographical model or leaking pool model illustrates it clearly. To me, it does a much better job than the standard disease type graphs that you see everywhere. In two following videos, I'm going to use a leaky poo model to explain two things. In the first video, I'll explain why people with MS might feel like shit, feel bad during a heat wave, after a COVID-19 vaccine, a fever, a bad night's sleep, or a stressful event. In the second video, I'll talk about why some experts think that treating MS effectively very early on in the disease might even cure it. Subscribe to the channel and press the bell icon so you don't miss any of those videos. I hope that you learned as much from watching this video as I did preparing it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye! We'll be right back.